So we continue today with my overview of Diffusion Monte Carlo, and you're going to get a lot more details later on from Miguel Morales and some other people. So this is going to be kind of a flying view in the next hour and a half. So, but you're certainly willing to ask me questions, and some of the times I'll say or refer to something more technical that Miguel is going to talk about. Okay, so the last lecture, we talked about variational Monte Carlo, and we talked about Markov chains, and we talked about many-body wave functions. And I ended up by saying some of the problems with variational Monte Carlo. Variational Monte Carlo, you posit some trial wave function, and you calculate an upper bound to the energy, and then you try to optimize that trial wave function to get the best upper bound you can. If there were no other method, that would be a good method, but you know, the problem is that it's limited by your imagination into what the trial wave function could be, and it's also your patience about how willing you are to explore more and more complicated forms of trial wave functions. And so this projector Monte Carlo is a more general method where the computer does some of the optimization for you. In some cases, it completely solves the problem. But unfortunately, for the practical problems we have, it doesn't, because of what we call the sine problem. Just a historical note, this method, which some people call, you know, real quantum Monte Carlo, was suggested by Fermi, supposedly. I've never actually seen a direct publication of Fermi, but it's referred to in a conference proceedings by Ulam and Koch that Fermi suggested this method, that you could relate the solution of a quantum mechanical problem to a stochastic process, to a Monte Carlo process. And there was some very early work in 1950 by Donsker and Cox who tried to solve the hydrogen atom using this method. You know, and mathematically it works. You can show that it works, as I'll discuss in a minute. The method sort of languished for 20 years or so when my advisor, Mao Kalas, at the Kron Institute, really developed the practical methods. And in particular, this paper was a huge step forward in 1974, where they solved the problem of the hard sphere problem with projector Monte Carlo. And if you can read the, where you can't read the abstract, you see they did 256 hard spheres, boson hard spheres, using these methods, and it includes some of the techniques that we're going to discuss, namely important sampling. That was one of the big advances that Donsker and Cox didn't have, was the idea of using important sampling to improve to minimize the variance of the process and make it actually practical. Now, the actual method that they used was called Green's function Monte Carlo. We're not going to discuss because it's kind of fallen out of usage these days, and a more simple version called diffusion Monte Carlo is used today. And so that's what we're going to talk about. So these are actually variants. Projector Monte Carlo is the name of the technique. It's based on this equation right here, which we'll discuss, this operator equation. But you know, originally it was called Green's function Monte Carlo. Now, diffusion Monte Carlo is a particular variant, and there's another variant called reptation Monte Carlo, which I don't think we're going to talk about very much. I mean, CubeCPAC has that capability, but I don't think we're going to cover it. I may be wrong. So anyway, what's the idea? Phi here is a many-body wave function, and this argument is time, but it's imaginary time, okay? And so basically, if there were an I here, I'm sorry this is so small, but you know, if you look over on the side, you might be able to see the equations better. But if this was an I here, this would be real-time evolution. So this is actually, there's no I here, so this is imaginary time evolution. Okay, but, and we'll see in a minute what this does to a wave function. But we start out with an assumed wave function at time equals zero. So this is the time argument. And this is how it evolves, the wave function evolves in time, according to the Heisenberg picture, right? Except we're in imaginary time. Now, one difference is we're going to put a zero of energy, and that's called the trial energy, ET. Okay, and that's just a shift in energy, and we need that in order to fix the normalization. Now, what we show, what I'll show in the next few minutes is that this is a diffusion and branching operator, and we can interpret it as a Markov chain. But there's an assumption, and that's the root of the fermion sign problem, is that we have to treat this initial wave function as a probability. But it's not a probability in quantum mechanics, it's an amplitude. You know, and the probability is the square of the amplitude. So this is the heart of the fermion sign problem. We're trying to interpret the wave function as a probability. But we'll get around that towards the end of the talk in terms of the fixed node method. But for many problems, you can assume that it is positive or non-negative, real and non-negative. And so for bosonic systems, you can interpret it as probability. And that's why Kalas, Levesque, and Verlet were able to solve the problem of 256 hard-core bosons because they could legitimately interpret the wave function as a probability. So you map the quantum many-body problem onto a stochastic process. But, you know, in general, wave functions, you can't do this. And it's not only fermions, we often call it the fermion sign problem, but it's actually, you know, it's not particularly fermions, it's any excitation, many-body excitation has this problem. And there is a way to avoid it, but the way to avoid it is called the fixed node or fixed phase method, and that introduces an approximation, which, you know, we'll discuss later. Now, so talking about diffusion Monte Carlo, or projector Monte Carlo in more detail, so here I put in arguments. I switched from phi to psi, sorry. But we have R means, again, the same as last lecture, is the three-dimensional phase space of the electrons. And the second argument is now the time. So this is going to be, this is where variational Monte Carlo comes in. We assume we take the best wave function we can for their initial conditions here. We know what it is. And then we hit it with this operator, e to the minus h times t. What does this do to a wave function? Let's first analyze it mathematically, right? Because this operator here, e to the minus ht, this is called the density, the many-body density matrix operator. And, you know, of course, we don't know what this is numerically, except for something like a harmonic oscillator. We don't know what it is. But there's a way we can get at it without knowing what it is. Okay, but first let's just imagine we could solve the problem. So we expand in terms of exact eigenfunctions and eigenvalues. Phi in this view graph are the exact many-body wave functions. We don't know what they are, but we know they exist, right? And so phi alpha is the alphath many-body state. And so we express the initial trial wave function. We expand it in terms of the exact eigenfunctions, phi alpha, and these are some sort of matrix elements here. The coefficients, this is the weight of the trial wave function in the alpha state, right? And we sum over the states, okay? And now we can hit this trial wave function with this many-body operator, and since there are eigenvalues, it, we can calculate the effect of the how the projector, this is the projector, e to the minus ht, on to the trial wave function, and this is the result. Basically, because of it's an eigenvalue, If phi is an eigenfunction of h, then we just get the eigenvalue here. And so we get this result. Now, we're interested in the equilibrium solution, that is the long-time solution, large t. Okay, you see, you have an exponential of e to the minus t e alpha. So you can see that at large time, the ground state is going to dominate the sum, because all the other states drop off exponentially fast relative to the ground state. So you get this equation here. So in other words, this operator projects out the ground state wave function. And the coefficient is the overlap between the initial trial function with the ground state. We often ignore this, but you know, mathematically you would have to say, if you're so unlucky to choose a trial wave function that has zero overlap with the ground state, you're in trouble. Okay, sometimes you can do that, but normally it's almost impossible to get an approximate wave function that has no overlap with the ground state. But if assuming that this coefficient is non-zero, if you operate at large t here with this projection operator, eventually you'll get the ground state wave function. And the normalization involves the ground state energy. And that's actually how we calculate the ground state energy, is we follow the normalization. That's one way of calculating, and see how the normalization behaves, because that tells us what the ground state energy is. Now, I told you ET was a constant, a shift of energy, and you can see now its role is to keep the normalization fixed at large time. And this will be important in a few minutes. If you choose the trial energy that's too big, so that this coefficient is negative, then your normalization will grow to plus infinity. If it's too small, it'll go to minus infinity. In order to keep the normalization fixed, you have to set it equal to the ground state energy. Now, how do you do that when you don't know what the ground state energy is? We'll talk about that. That's called population control. You have to have dynamics in your random walk to keep the normalization fixed. That is, okay. Now, so this is the mathematics. The basic result is we want to apply this operator. And by the way, I call this the density matrix operator. What we are doing is what is done in thermodynamics. It's the same. In thermodynamics, you go down from high temperature down to low temperature, you end up in the ground state, and that's because this is the Boltzmann operator, and T we often refer to as the inverse temperature. So large time means low temperature. It's not a fuzzy analogy, it's a precise analogy. That is, we're actually doing thermodynamics when we do this, and this is actually the basis of path integral Monte Carlo, which, again, we're not going to talk about because it's not in QMCPAC. But, you know, there's a very precise relationship between this and path integral Monte Carlo, and, you know, that's partly the reputation algorithm uses this. Now, we now want to relate it to a Markov process. Okay, and this, if you take the time derivative of this equation here, that is the t derivative, right, you pull down an h, and you see you end up with this equation, right? So this is kind of called the imaginary time block equation, right? It's like the Schrodinger time-dependent Schrodinger equation, except you don't have the I, right? It's an imaginary time. So this is, I think, where Fermi started off and realizing that there was an analogy here. You can think about this as a master equation in a stochastic process. A master equation means if you have a random process, you know, how does the probability change in time? Okay, so if we're going to interpret phi as a probability density, so this is going to be interpreted as a probability of the whole system being at a point r at time t. So this is the rate of change in time. And let's break up the Hamiltonian into a kinetic part and a potential part. And there's two rates here. I separated them out into the kinetic part and the potential part. If you were going to solve these two equations by a random walk or by a stochastic process, what would you do? Does anybody know what this equation is? It's the diffusion equation. It's in chemistry they call Fick's law. This means that if you have random walks, they diffuse out from a point in time t, and this h bar squared over 2m is the diffusion constant, how fast they move per unit time. All right? Now, what's the second equation? Is that a diffusion equation? No. No, it's not a Langevin equation. No. Suppose it's what?
You reach a limit and you do that.
Imagine that the psi was a bunch of bacteria in a pond, or organism in a pond. Yes, and this is the diffusion of moving around the bacteria, algae in a pond, right? Diffusion. What would this be?
Source.
Not exactly source, but close. It's a growth-death process. Now, the difference with the source is like you're dumping bacteria into the pond. That's a source. But this is saying that the bacteria grow with the rate proportional to V of R. V of R, of course, in quantum mechanics is the potential. But here, suppose you were dumping fertilizer in the pond. They would grow faster where the fertilizer is, right? And the V of R, this would be... this would be negative because there's the minus sign here. They would grow. On the other hand, if you dump poison in the pond, they would die off, right? And this would be positive, and that would kill off the bacteria, right? So you can imagine in this pond, there's these two different processes going on. First, you're dumping in fertilizer and bacteria at certain places. That causes growth and death of the bacteria. Secondly, they're diffusing around and they're mixing together. And voila, the Schrodinger equation is the intermixing of these two terms, right? It's this, the whole thing, right? And this is actually justified mathematically to break it up. And so actually the mathematical justification goes by the name of Trotter's formula. And if you write it down in this form, it's something that you learn in algebra. Again, the density matrix operator is this, right? It's e to the minus, and a and b, I write down, are kinetic and potential operators. So what we can do is we can divide it. We don't know what this is, and we have to sample this in the Monte Carlo process. But what we do is we divide it into little pieces, and we take, and then we can assume that A and B commute because the commutator, the error in going from here to here involves the commutator of these two terms, and that has a 1 over n squared in it. And that goes to 0 as n goes to infinity. So this is Trotter's formula that says for very general operators A and B, this is equal to that in the limit as n goes to infinity. In particular, it holds if A is the potential operator and B is the kinetic operator. But it holds as long as A and B are kind of reasonable operators. Of course, you can make very pathological operators that violates Trotter's formula, but in general, it's true. Now, what does this mean in terms of our... So this is the mathematical justification of what we're about to do. It's not an uncontrolled approximation. It's a perfectly controlled approximation in the limit of n goes to infinity. N is simply you divide time into n steps. So it's exactly like molecular dynamics having a time step. Molecular dynamics is exact if you make small enough time steps, right? How small do you make them? Well, you know how you do this. You just try to make them smaller and smaller till your results are independent of the time step, right? So that's the time step error. But what does this mean in terms of our random walk. This looks like kind of an abstract operator notation. Well, you insert particle coordinates into it. So remember, this we're going to interpret as a probability for going from R0 to Rn. And this is the operator that we want to, this is the probability which is related to this operator. So we divide it into n steps. N is this exponent here. And so we go from R0 to R1, R1 to R2, and so forth up to Rn. And we calculate what e to the minus ta is and e to the tb is, which we can do because now they're just bare kinetic and potential operators. And so this is the random walk that goes from R0 to Rn. And what are these matrix elements? So again, we have this, and this is the Trotter's formula. So this is just repeating a little bit larger here. We have to estimate what these two, or calculate what these two matrix elements are of the kinetic and potential. Well, the kinetic energy is just the solution of a diffusion problem. That is, that was that diffusion equation. So it is the, if you start at a point R, it's the probability of reaching point R prime after a time tau, I called it. Okay, and you know that that's a Gaussian. This is the solution to the diffusion problem, which you probably learned at some point, right? And you can prove this by Fourier transforms, but I won't go through that. Now, how about the potential term? Well, because the potential, if we're working with something that's diagonal, that's a function of R only, not like a pseudo-potential is not a function of R, but if we're looking at something as a function of R, then we don't have to do anything. Basically, it doesn't move, and the solution is just e to the minus tau times the potential energy. So, in other words, this is the mini body. This is the mini body operator, e to the minus beta tau. You can express it as a random walk from going from zero to n, and you have a diffusion step, and then you have this multiplication step where, again, if you think of these as bacteria, the bacteria diffuses from R0 to R1. It multiplies by e to the minus tau v at R1, and then it diffuses from R1 to R2 and goes up to Rn and repeats it. So it's a diffusion and branching process. And so that's the basic diffusion Monte Carlo algorithm, which this is exactly what Fermi realized. So we construct an ensemble, a population. This is the number of bacteria in the pond, if you like, sampled from a trial wave function. We'll call them R1, R2, up to Rp. Again, capital R means it's the full three-dimensional coordinates vector of points of where the electrons are. And P is the population or the ensemble size or the number of walkers. These are often called walkers, right? One iteration or one time step means you evolve this whole ensemble of walkers, right? And this is a very simple algorithm. The kth walker, you take a Gaussian random number. Why Gaussian? That's the solution to the diffusion problem. The square root of tau indicates that as the time step gets small, you move a small distance. Right? This is how far you move. This is the new point. This is the diffusion step. Now, you have to do the branching step, that is the birth and death of the walker. So you calculate e to the minus tau times the potential energy minus the trial energy. That's the number of copies that you want to make. That's how much the bacteria grows or dies, right? But wait, that's a floating point number. So how do you make, say, 1.5 copies? Well, there's a very simple rule. The best way to do it is to take a random number between 0 and 1 and you add it to this number, and then you throw away the fractional part. That's what this bar means underneath. That's a floor function. So you take it, it's a floating point number, and you throw away the fractional part. Okay, suppose this number was 1.5, because V is a little less than ET, so this number is negative, so that the exponent is positive, and so you get a number like 1.5. You add a random number between 0 and 1, there would be a 50% chance it would be 2 and a 50% chance it would be 1. So half the time you would make two copies and half the time you would make one copy. You see the average number of copies you make is 1.5. So that's the way it works. If this number were 1.9, then 90% of the time you would make two copies and 10% of the time you would make one copy. So that's why this formula works, that the average number of copies you make is given by this. So now you have your walkers, you have a list of walkers, and you figured out how many copies that you're making, right? And so, of course, you can imagine how easy this is to do on the computer. You know, you put, you just take this point R, and you just, if you're going to make two copies, you just copy it in another one memory, and you increment the population, say one more population. You have a list of the walkers, right? Of course, this is also how easy it is to parallelize QMC codes, right? Nobody says that these walkers have to be on the same processor, right? They can have 1,000 processors, say each processor has about 10 walkers. Every so often you have to move them around from processor to processor to keep them balanced. But because all the work in quantum Monte Carlo is calculating the trial wave function, moving them around is zero amount of work, so that's why it's so easy to parallelize. So that's the basic branching diffusion random walk, right? Now, how do you calculate the ground state energy? Yeah? Not the trial function, we're mapping the exact wave function. Yeah.
The exact wave function into some sort of particles which are discrete.
Well, we have electrons at definite positions, that's right. So the wave function is the probability distribution of where these electrons are going to be.
So you use that
for it's the wave function that's proportional probability, which is, of course, in violation of quantum mechanics. And quantum mechanics is supposed to be the wave function squared. That's why we have the sine problem. But that's the way it works, and it works. Any other questions? Okay. Now, how do we calculate the energy? Well, basically, you want to adjust this trial energy, which appears in here, in order to keep the population fixed. Remember my analogy with putting fertilizer and poison in the pond. Well, okay, so you have to keep adjusting your diet in order to keep your population of bacteria stable, right? And that's one way to think about it. There's another way to think about it. And remember I said that the asymptotic distribution is equal to the ground state wave function. So if we apply the Hamiltonian, if we look at this ratio here, because H applies to the right-hand side, and this is the exact wave function, this is going to give us the ground state energy. If H is a Hermitian operator, it applies to the left. Well, H is considered a kinetic part and a potential part. If it applies to the left, the kinetic part is zero because there's no operator, no function on the left side. And so you just have the potential energy. H is, you know, T plus V, so you just have V. So that would be the average potential energy. And so the ground state energy paradoxically is equal to the average potential energy. We'll explain this a little bit later. It's again because we're sampling the wave function, not the square of the wave function, that you have this. And that's not surprising, because if you look up here, in order to keep the population fixed, you want the trial energy to equal the potential energy. But this is another way of seeing that, right? So you can just keep, in this simple, there's no important sampling yet, in this simple, no important sampling version, the ground state energy is equal to potential energy. But there's multiple problems that I'm going to talk about now. Branching is uncontrolled, we say. I mean, what happens, this is actually what happened with Donsker and Cox in 1950. What happens when an electron goes into the proton and V goes to minus infinity, and you get millions of branches? You know, their computers back in 1950 certainly couldn't handle this, right? You know, you get huge fluctuations, which we can control with important sampling. The population is unstable. I'll talk about that. And then the big question is, what do we do with fermions? This is actually carrying out this simple algorithm for a harmonic oscillator. It's just too faint. But here shows you how the population evolves. You start out with 50 walkers, and you end up with 10 walkers. There's no control of the population here. And so here are the walkers. This is a harmonic oscillator, so this is the bottom of the well here. And, you know, they're evolving. A lot of the ones that go out here die off, right? And the ones that stay in the middle grow. And this is the exact wave function, and that's the computed wave function. Of course, it's noisy because there's only 10 walkers by the end. Now, let me address this issue of population bias. It's not really very complicated, but I know it's something people worry about. The algorithm that we talked about, requires that you maintain the walker population. I mean, either your walkers can grow to plus infinity, or they can shrink down to zero, in which either case is a disaster for the calculation. And in addition, you don't know what trial energy to use if you've never done the problem before. So it turns out that, well, because this is a Markov process, you always have to control the population because it's an unstable equilibrium. There's nothing in the algorithm that says you should stay at 100 walkers, so it will either grow to infinity or zero, or shrink to zero. And so you have to put some kind of a feedback mechanism in there. And this is the simplest way to put it in, and I think it's actually one of the best ways to put it in. Suppose P0 is your desired population of walkers, and PT is the current population, then you can just ask the question of how do we have to adjust the trial energy so it goes back to your desired level. Well, given what I wrote, it's easy to write down this equation. The average population at some time capital T in the future is given by this factor. This is the growth, the average growth of the population, which involves the trial energy and the ground state energy and the time it's evolving, times the current population. So you want to set this equal at some time capital T in the future to your desired population PZ. Now you just solve this equation for ET, this equation here. So, you know, this is the solution of that equation. You just take the logarithm, right, to solve for ET. Okay, and this says that you should adjust your trial energy to equal the ground state energy plus this logarithm of the ratio of your desired population to your current population divided by capital T. Capital T is your feedback parameter. It tells you how quickly, suppose you're working at a walker population of 1,000 walkers, and after some time it fluctuates up to 2,000 walkers, and this is too slow. So you say, well, after 100 generations, I want it to be back down to 1,000, right? So this ratio is 1,000 over 2,000, and this thing is, you know, whatever time that is in the future. And this says you should bump up the trial energy I'm sorry, reduce the trial energy, because that would be negative, by a little bit, and that will kill off the walkers. It'll slowly kill off the walkers until your population gets down to where you wanted it, right? So there's several parameters in here, you understand. Okay, E0 is now your best estimate of the ground state energy. Okay, so usually that's taken to be the average over the last few blocks of what you think the ground state energy is. T, capital T, is how quickly, how tightly do you want the walker population to be controlled? If T is small, you keep it very much under control. 1,000 walkers, you know, it fluctuates, say, by a few percent to 1,100 or 900 or whatever. And P of T is your current walker population. P0 is your desired one. Okay. Now, the disadvantage with population control is that we no longer have the theorem that we introduce a bias, a systematic error, by controlling the population. The bias, however, is, in my experience, is very, very small. But there is a bias. There's no question about that. It raises the energy. All population control mechanisms do bias the energy, but it's related to the trial energy. And so if you have, this is why you want to have a large population, because if you have 1,000,000 walkers, they're not going to fluctuate as much as 1,000 walkers would. So this is something that should have been put to rest by the huge computers that we have now. Because now, I mean, in the old days, 30 years ago, I had to work with 200 walkers. But now you can work with 200,000 easily. And that should have reduced the bias by a factor of 1,000. And it depends a lot on the trial wave function and so forth. But the lesson is, you don't want to try to micromanage your walker population. You don't want to keep it right at P0. That's the largest bias. There's other methods that do keep it right at P0, and they will have a larger bias, even though you have less problems with estimating how much computer time it will take per step. Because when the walker population fluctuates, the computer time per step is fluctuating too. But the advantage with Monte Carlo is that it doesn't matter. It's a stochastic process. You've got to let things fluctuate, right? That's the advantage of that's the strength of Monte Carlo. So you want to make this T as large as possible. What do I mean? Well, when it's too large, you get catastrophic failures. That is, if you make it too big, your walkers may go down to zero and your run will stop, right? Because you have no walkers left. Or it may go from 1,000 walkers, it may go up to 1,000,000 walkers, and you cannot even complete one step in the allocated time. So that would be a catastrophe, right? But you want your walker population to fluctuate within those limits. And I usually say like 20%. You can have the walker population fluctuate by 20%, because it's not like those walkers are wasted when they're fluctuating. They're still giving you statistical information, right? Okay, now we come to an important step where introduced by Kalos in 1970, important sampling. Important sampling is a general Monte Carlo technique, not just quantum Monte Carlo. It means with what distribution, you ask the question, which distribution should you sample from to reduce your variance? You should ask that question with important sampling. It has many, many applications. The physically correct probability of distribution is the wave function squared, and we've been sampling the wave function. So this suggests that we should multiply by something that's like the wave function, so we get the wave function squared. Okay. Now, remember this block equation back here. Okay. What I'm going to do is multiply that equation by a trial wave function. just multiply the equation by the trial wave function and interpret the product as the thing that I want to sample. So the trial wave function in phi is the unknown wave function. Okay, so I'm going to deal with this f function instead of the phi function. So psi t is an analytically known, your best approximation to the ground state wave function. Okay? Now, the theorem that I proved before about projector Monte Carlo, it implies immediately that f is going to be psi t times the ground state wave function. So this is the so-called mixed estimator, is what we sample. And the idea is that this should be much physically more reasonable than just the wave function. But now let's see, what is the effect on the random walk process? What I did is I multiplied that evolution equation by psi t, and I have f, because psi t doesn't involve time, so it commutes through the time derivative, right? So I have df dt on the left side. Now here, I had the Hamiltonian times phi before, so I have to have f over psi t, and I have a psi t on the left. So this is just a simple, straightforward change of the evolution equation. So this is now the evolution equation for f. Okay, now we do a step which is to commute the psi t through h. And h consists of a kinetic term and a potential term, right? And of course, the potential term, psi t will commute through it, but it doesn't commute through the kinetic term. And you end up with this equation when you do the commutations, okay? Which is now the master equation for f. We're going to interpret now f as a probability distribution instead of psi. And this is the so-called master equation. And before, we only had two terms. Before, we had the diffusion term, and we had a term like this, which was the potential energy. And now we have a new term. We're going to explore what the new term does. So actually, we have two new terms. We have both of these. This has changed, and that's changed. Now, this term should be familiar from yesterday, right? Somebody say it. Local energy, right? This is h psi t over psi t. So if psi t was equal to 1, no important sampling, this would be potential energy. But now it's a local energy. So now this is the air. So this is not an operator, by the way. That's what the bracket means. It's a function. It's a function. It's not an operator. And so it's just, this is the branching term, right? Because branching in a master equation is represented by function times your probability. So your branching is now on the local energy. So remember, the whole point of the local energy is your error and your trial function. So by putting in the cusp condition, you eliminate this singularity at r equals 0. So you no longer have this catastrophe when an electron would go into a nucleus. Now, with the cusp condition, it's nice and smooth there, right? And as you get better trial functions, you have less branching, you have less population control problems, things go along like they do in variational Monte Carlo. But, of course, if you have this term change, you have a new term to counterbalance it, right? And this is the so-called drift term. So remember, according to Trotter's formula, what we want to do is we want to analyze each term separately. The question is, if we just have, okay, what is the structure of this term? This term is the gradient times the probability times a function of position, a vector of position. These are two vectors. So this term from yesterday, remember, is what we called the quantum force, the gradient of the log of the trial function. We have an equation like this. And the solution, actually, you learn this in elementary mechanics, is just a drifting solution, right? That is, the solution to this kind of equation is whatever function you have, it just moves proportional to time, right? So that's just a drift process. So now our evolution consists of three processes. diffusion, drift, and branching. These two terms conserve probability, and these are exactly what we introduced in variational Monte Carlo by smart Monte Carlo. That's why I said the reason why we use smart Monte Carlo and variational Monte Carlo is that so we can use the same subroutines or same functions as you do in diffusion Monte Carlo. So our new algorithm is the following. The new point, again, we have a population of walkers. We first have a diffusion step, a diffusion plus drift step, which is the new point is the old point plus a drift, which is given by the gradient of the log of the trial function times the time step. And then we have a noise term that we add to it. The branching is change. So now the branching is based on the deviation of the local energy from the trial energy. And this is the local energy. So as I said, the whole computer time in quantum Monte Carlo is spent calculating these two terms, the trial wave function. You don't want to make any crude approximations to the trial function. The better your trial function is, the better the algorithm is, basically. We still determine ET by keeping the population stable. Everything I said about population control still applies. The ground state energy now, we can write the ground state energy as the ratio of these two integrals. And if we apply H to the left, you see that's equal to the ground state because this phi goes to the ground state wave function. H to the left, we get E0. If we apply H to the right, we get the local energy. So the ground state, the best way to estimate the ground state energy is just to take the average value of the local energy. And again, that's the thing that keeps your population stable, right? Now, there's another thing that we do. It's called the accept-reject step. And, you know, that's not so obvious. It's not required by Trotter's formula. You don't have to do that, but I'll explain why you want to do that. It's exactly the same thing that we do in Metropolis Monte Carlo. And that seems strange because it seems strange that you have this algorithm that doesn't involve any accept-reject. It's just a deterministic thing. So why should you add this step? Well, you'd add it because it cuts down on your time step errors enormously. Basically, the motivation is the following. This is the important sampled Green's function right here. This is tells you what is the probability of moving from a point r to a point r prime. It's given by, this is your evolution operator, and this is your important sampling here. You have this exact identity. That is, psi squared times the probability moving to r prime is a reverse probability. This is, remember from yesterday, the detailed balance condition. It's a little different than in stochastic processes because of the branching. Okay, but it still holds, which because this is H is a Hermitian operator. I view this, enforcing this condition is like enforcing energy conservation in molecular dynamics. You want to enforce, this is a higher level principle. Any method for diffusion Monte Carlo should enforce this principle because it keeps the probabilities, it keeps the flow of probabilities, you know, correctly normalized. The simplest way to do that is just to use the Metropolis formula where you make a trial move and you compute this ratio, and you accept or reject according to this ratio. That enforces this detail balance rule, enforces this symmetry between r and r prime. But there's a difference with variational Monte Carlo. Remember in variational Monte Carlo, we set the time step to get something like 50% acceptance ratio. Here, the philosophy is different. We want a small time step error, so we keep usually, we talk about 99% acceptance ratio. So that would mean you move 100 electrons. We still move electrons one at a time, typically, for the same reasoning we do in variational Monte Carlo, but say 1 in 100 gets rejected. It doesn't move anywhere. And why to do this? Well, one of the reasons you can say is your time step error you know that it's proportional to how small tau is. Maybe it's like tau squared if you have a good integrator. This puts a coefficient in front which is proportional to how bad your trial function is. So in other words, the time step error not only goes to zero as tau squared, but it goes to zero as your trial function goes to the exact wave function. So you go to zero two different directions. And so that makes you get a much smaller time step error and you get a much more robust algorithm. Because what can happen if you look at this algorithm, what could go bad in this algorithm? Well, one of the things that can go bad is that there are some places where this force diverges to infinity, right? If psi t goes to zero, the force diverges. Just imagine you have a little molecule and all of a sudden you take a move and it says, oh, move this electron 100 angstroms away. This is actually where I discovered the rejection algorithm. I said, well, let's just throw those out. But then I thought there should be a better principle involved than just throwing out bad moves. Basically, you never want this force to become too big relative to tau. And okay, in the accept-reject algorithm, you move 100 angstroms away, and this psi ratio of size is just going to say, no, bad move, reject it, try again, you know. It gives you a precise rule for doing that, a principle, and not just having to go in your code and figure out all the ways things could go bad. It just gives you a principle to do it by. And it gives you a way of setting the time step without having to do a time step study. You can just look at the accept reject, yeah? You know, so again, this is the scheme. We have four walkers here. Each one has three electrons, those little squares in the box. You know, we generate new configurations with a drifting random walk. We calculate these multiplicities, and this one had 0.8, it got killed off. This one had 1.6, it ended up with 1. And this one had 2.2, it ended up with 2 walkers. This one got 0.3, it got killed off. So you went from 4 walkers to 3. And that's the idea. And then you just repeat many, many times. And here's a little bit of pseudocode, but I think.
Sorry, the way you kill them is if it is less than 1, you kill them.
Yeah. And if it's you calculate this e to the minus tau times the local energy. Okay. And that's a number between 0 and infinity. You add a random number between 0 and 1. You truncate. And if it's 0, you kill it. If it's 1, you don't do anything. If it's 2, you make a copy. 3, you make 2 copies, like that.
That's why the 2.2 becomes 2, and yeah. 2.6 becomes 1.
Well, no, I didn't say here. I didn't say here what the random numbers were, but yes, that's right, in this example. You have initial state where you set up the walkers. You calculate the wave functions. You have loops. Now you have 2 loops, one over iterations and one over walkers. You sample a new position, a new wave function, and you calculate the drift velocity. You sample a new position. You calculate the acceptance probability. T is, again, the smart Monte Carlo drifting random walk. You calculate the acceptance passes, you compare it to a random number. If it passes, you replace the walker with a new walker. You calculate this weight, which is the local energy, and then actually I didn't have the branching step in here, but use this weight. I'm not sure where the slide came from, but use this weight to calculate the branching probability.